right next to me at the moment is St. John Green, the real gentleman that I play. Sind wrote a book, which was a story of his relationship with Kate, who he prematurely lost. Kate and Sind have been together since they were very young. They were soulmates. They had two children together after a lot of trying. Their youngest son was diagnosed with a very aggressive form of cancer. He recovered after being given an 8% chance of survival. And then his wife, Kate, was diagnosed with an incurable breast cancer. And he lost her. And before he died, he wrote her a list of things. She wrote him text messages and post-it notes and lots of different things that she would like him to do with the children. Hence the title of the book and the movie, Mum's List. Well, this is the thing. When you go and do a film like this, you know that you're making something and representing something that everybody can identify with. Everybody's experienced loss and know someone close to them with cancer. And that's a big responsibility. It's also a big responsibility to play somebody who is still alive, who lived this very recently, who has children that are still alive, who have lost their mother. And I knew that we were in very safe hands with the director because his children went to school with Sinji's children. And he was going to give an honest, sensitive portrayal without it being gratuitous. But as I've said, all of the challenges, everything that goes into it is nothing in relation to what it's like to actually experience it. I am simply honoured to have been asked to do it. It was a wonderful thing to be a part of.
The big challenges, you're telling someone's life, you're telling a true story. Not only that, you're telling the story of someone who can't be here. So the book was very much from Sinji's point of view, which it has to be, it's his memoir. I knew the film had to follow Kate home, and I knew therefore that we are presenting Kate to an audience. And it's a massive responsibility, and it's a challenge. And what you do is you share that responsibility and that challenge with the most professional people. And our crew and our cast, led by Amelia Fox and Rafe Spall, they understood the nuances of this story, which is a tragic, beautiful romance. And the joy of it and the pleasure that came from it was everyone realizing how special this was and how privileged we were to tell this story. I actually have a very personal connection. I live in the town where it happened. My boys, Tom and Joe, they go to the same school as Reef and Finn. I knew Kate in the last year of her life. At first, I was slightly resistant to being involved in the film because I knew that there's risks in presenting a story like this in a film. And I said to Sinj, I'll stand by you and I'll help you when the producers and the directors want to alter your story. Gradually, I began to realize that actually I could tell the version that I felt comfortable with that was actually being defined by those same rules I was going to hand over to Sinch. And I think the joy of doing it is finding a bunch of people you work with who understand the delicacies and the nuances and were working so hard in every shoot. There's moments when crew come up and say, oh, it was an amazing scene. I really felt, oh, happens in every shoot. Here, the fact that they knew that we were walking in the footsteps of the real people because we were filming in that town, that these events actually happened to someone, and that the other person who's still here, Sinj, he would come for breakfast, and everyone got to know him. It became this beautiful family affair, and that was a real privilege to be in the middle of all of that. I think the value of taking one family in particular, is what Kate's List did was arm Sinj. It's not a bucket list. She wasn't writing the things she wants to do. When Sinj said to her in the last 3 months of her life, how do I cope without you? She began by giving him quite simplistic instructions, very basic instructions. And then she realized this was her chance. This is her chance to remain. We all want to remain. We all want to feel that we're remembered. Most of us have the benefit of a long, long life for us to be memories, living memories within our families. But she knew she had to create this. And that list became this profound memorializing of herself. So I think this family in particular, their story has meaning within the greater context of how cancer touches us. And there's a woman who put herself out there. She gave Sinj the armory that he used to help move on. Rafe and Millie are incredible in this film. They're both parents. They're both people who have experienced love. and they also understand humanity. And I think that's the biggest thing. They've got heart, both of them. With Millie, it was a chance. I know Millie very well from working with her 10 years ago in Keeping Mum. And there's a side to Millie that's warm and loving, which sometimes her roles don't allow her to present. And I knew that she has those qualities. With Rafe, he's a man who can just take a scene and turn it into something massively profound. He has such a heart. They both do. And I felt we want people who are normal people, who we can fall in love with. The film is there to make people fall in love with Kate and with Singe. And I think that there's no better than Rafe and Millie to communicate that. I hope this film most achieves spreading a bit of love. I think we should all remember life is short. We have one chance. And we should make the most of every moment with those we love and who love us. There's nothing better than doing that.
It's a very surreal moment, honestly. The boys and myself are just sort of like blown away by the media attention. What can you say? I mean, I think she'd be bemused. I think she'd be really proud of what we've done. The boys have already said, Mummy would be so proud. And I think that's right, you know. I think she really would. I hope she can look down on us, and I hope she's changed a lot of people's lives with our story. So, yeah, I think we've knocked it out of the park, really. Well, it didn't start off that way, to be honest. I mean, the reason I wrote the book in the first place was to share my love for Kate and these boys' mum with them. And to actually suddenly have it being put into a book was the most surreal. I keep saying my English teacher would be banging her head on the table wondering how the hell I did it, because, you know, I was rubbish at English and everybody told me to stick to maths because I was good at that. And then all of a sudden you get a book which becomes a bestseller and they make a movie of it. It's crazy. It really is.
Kate was a unique, a remarkable woman. Is Amelia Fox a close substitute, as good as we can get for an on-screen representation?
What can I say? Absolutely. She's amazing. She's beautiful. She's got that feisty spirit, which Kate had, and she plays her brilliantly. I must admit, she breaks my heart every time I see her on the screen. She's amazing. Really amazing.
Can you talk about working with Rafe? Obviously a great actor, and it must be a bit strange having him portraying you on screen.
I love telling my mates I'm 6 foot in the movies. So yeah, he's awesome. He's done me proud and he's looked after me on set as well. You know, he drove my boat and he didn't break it. So we're all good. We're good mates.
I got involved actually through my friend Rafe, who is in the film. And he very kindly suggested to the director that he listen to some of my music, which he did. And that led to me doing the music, which was fantastic. So that's how I got involved. I think it's important because I guess, you know, because of the book and the book's existence, and it was just the next kind of natural step in that journey. And I just think to memorialise this incredible woman is only a good thing, as long as it's done in a respectful way. And for me personally, I just found it a very interesting, an amazing exercise in being grateful and thankful. And if anybody can hear this story or see this film and feel the same way about their family, then it's just, it can only be a good thing.
Talking about good things, my final question, what are you moving on to next?
I am working on another film I'm doing the music for, and I'm really excited about it, but I'm not going to say because it's not like totally official, so I don't want to jinx it.
So I was asked to write a song initially, and it was the first time I'd been asked to write a song for a film, and so I was absolutely over the moon that I'd even been asked. So I wrote a song called Something So Beautiful, which luckily they all loved, which was great. And they also decided, the team decided they wanted to use another one of my songs called Grow, which has ended up being kind of part of the official soundtrack. And then a lovely singer called Lauren Aquilina has sung the other song that I wrote. So to have two songs in there is amazing, and to be part of the whole thing is just incredible. I think, tonight's going to be the first time I've seen the film in full. But from what I've seen of it, I think it's dramatised in such a... It's obviously really emotional, but it's actually so uplifting. And it shows how actually families, or in this horrible situation that families can be put in, you can come together and you can still laugh and you can still have fun together. And just the way that, you know, Sinja's family, all of them have just come together, and the fact that they've made this film in tribute, it's amazing. Amazing. I've just announced my first album, so that's going to be out next year in March. So that's the main thing I'm kind of getting ready for. And then there'll be lots of touring and lots more writing, so it's an exciting time.
The tracks on this soundtrack, quite a good indication of what fans can expect from the album?
Yes, yeah, definitely. I guess the songs that are on with the soundtrack are my more kind of ballady songs, which is kind of my most, where I'm most comfortable, sat at the piano. But on my album, there are some other songs that are, have some drums on them and experiment with other sounds as well. So.
It wasn't actually too long ago that some of the producers heard a track of mine that's on my upcoming album called The Waiting Game, and the track is called Angel Like You. It's a song, very, very sad song, close to my heart, but it's also very inspiring, and hopefully people can gain comfort from it, because it was about a lady that passed away, a close family friend. And I guess when they heard the song, they felt it was completely perfect for the movie, because it's all about someone who passed away far before their time, and but that they're an angel, and they're there, always there, and you want them to help you through the difficult time. I just think that in general, in life, you know, music, film, everything, you just know that you're not alone. And that, you know, there's so many other people out there all going through the same thing, and you kind of like, it gives that feeling of huge, almost relief and comfort to know that you're not alone.
Are you a fan of people like Rafe and Amelia? And because I think it's important for a project like this to have people of that quality attached.
Yeah, they are fantastic, fantastic actors, like huge names, and you know, they've done great work in the past. I'm so excited to see them in this movie. I heard that they've captured the parts 100%, and you know, I'm sure that everyone's going to love it. We've got my album coming out in February called The Waiting Game, and my first single called Stay My Love is coming out in January, and so that's basically it for me. I'm really excited. First solo album.
Fans who are literally waiting with bated breath for that, what can they expect from the album overall?
Well, it's an album I wrote over the past 2 to 3 years. I put everything into it. It's all, you know, it's got good, some slow songs, some fast songs. It's very much more acoustic, kind of country pop, a lot different to what they might have heard with the Saturdays, but it's very true to myself and kind of, you know, going back to my roots, I guess.
How does the experience of working on solo material compare with being with the rest of the girl?
It's different, obviously, you know, and I miss the girls all the time, not having them here with me, but, you know, we're all great friends, and we're all just sort of trying different things now and all supporting each other, so it's not a bad thing at the same time, it's just very different, obviously.
Well, you mentioned the first single is on its way. Is that quite a good indication of what the rest of the album's going to sound like in general?
Yeah, it's actually a duet with Sam Palladio. He's from the TV show Nashville. So, yeah, so that's going to be nice to have him there too. So I'm not completely alone starting out, you know. And it's a sad, slow song. Very, very true to the kind of the album, I guess. But it's one of my slower ones. It's a ballad.
So he's a great partner to have. How did that come about?
Well, we actually approached him because we felt this song sounds like I co-wrote it with Amy Wedge. She's a fantastic singer-songwriter. And we both said, this sounds like it could be a duet. So we kind of brainstormed, and he sprung up, and we approached him, and he was delighted to take part. So we're very lucky to have him on the song.
Apart from that track, is there a specific track on the album that you're most excited for people to finally get a chance to hear?
I think this Angel Like You is one of the ones I'm being very excited for people to hear and to enjoy. But yes, to Stay My Love. There's so many of them. They're all, you know, they're all so close to my heart, obviously. They're like my little babies, and can't wait for to share them with everyone. But I think Angel Like You, definitely people, I can't wait for them to hear it.
There's going to be some live dates as well, so people can get a chance to hear them in person.
Yeah, I hope to do a tour, or a few dates anyway, starting off early next year, and then see where it goes. But yeah, I can't wait. I've just come off supporting Maddie and Tay and Ward Thomas, so that was a great, great start. Can't wait for you all to jump on board The Waiting Game and, you know, enjoy this ride with me.
The younger version of Kate. Half the film is you see the flashbacks to when Kate and Singe first met, how they fell in love, and how their relationship developed. So I play young Kate and Ross McCormack plays young Singe. So we had the absolute honour of, you know, reenacting these amazing scenes of how they met in the roller rink, how they fell in love, and yeah, it's been an absolute honour to do that. It was just so real, like you. I remember reading the script for the first time and being like, it's so real and raw and complete. And it's really rare that you find a love like that. That's just so, you know, like epic. It's crazy. And you know, you read about them writing to each other. They wrote each other letters about, because there was no text and phone, like Cindy reminded me. You know, about how much they loved each other, acres and acres. You know, those words really stuck with me, and I use that phrase now. It's something that Kate made up, and it's just fantastic.
it's such a fantastic film, you just can't not see it. And it's really important sometimes to experience things like that, because this is what people are living. This is real. Like, this is a true story. It's important to see other people, you know, living their own lives, and also the story. It is sad, of course. Any loss story is sad, but it's also beautiful. And the way it's shot, like Eben Bolter, our DP, is just fantastic. And it's a real piece of art. So if you want to see some art, then come see this. Me and Ross came in. We didn't have, like, a week schedule. We came in every now and then to do our scenes, which was amazing. And obviously we were so excited, and it's quite a demanding film for Rafe and Amelia. We didn't actually get to do any scenes with them apart from one with Rafe, which was amazing to work with him. He's like a really talented, incredible actor, and he really gets in the scene. So it really helps you when you have someone of that, you know, who's so established, because you really want to work with them, and he's amazing to bounce off. So that opportunity was great, yeah. I mean, mainly me and Ross do all our scenes together, and we met in the second audition. We literally got the audition one day, the next day we were cast, and I met him and we read through the lines, and it just worked, you know. It was really important, I think, to find someone who we genuinely clicked with, and me and Ross get on really, really well. So yeah, it was an absolute pleasure to film with him.
The audiences are going to take a lot of different things from this film. Overall, what's the one thing that you've most taken away from your involvement in the film?
The importance of family, and, you know, the importance of loving people and appreciating people. I mean, this, you deal with loss in this film, and you see how that affects people, but you also see how it brings people together. And it's really important to, you know, appreciate people, especially whilst they're there, and, you know, love your family for when they are there. So I've got the finale of The Lodge, which is coming out on Disney Channel next week. So we're just, you know, working towards that. And yeah, we're just, I mean, this is releasing now, so we're just getting all the buzz from there. Got I appear in Endeavour, which is coming out in the new year as well, so hopefully keep an eye out for that.
I play young Singe, who is a young version of Rafe's Spall, and it's the story of how Singe and Kate met, and they met at a roller disco and fell in love completely straight away, and then kind of the rest is history. And I won't give away too much about what happens, because it's a lovely story, but yeah, my part is a lot of how they fell in love, how they met, and just how much they adored each other, and the things they shared, the little moments, and yeah, that's a lot of what I play in the film. It's a special love story because it's about giving, and the idea of how they've met from so young, and they were so devoted to each other and their families, and especially Kate with the kids and Singe, devoted to them having a better life even after she was gone. And that's an amazing, I don't know, kind of bravery from Kate. And it makes it all the more, I guess, sad as to what has happened. But, I don't know, it makes you feel grateful that people like that are alive. And that's what I think the film kind of represents, just pure love and human compassion.
And, of course, you and Sophie are playing the younger versions of Rafe and Amelia's characters. Can you talk a little bit about how closely you work together to create a continuity?
Yeah, well, me and Rafe especially became quite close on set, and obviously, we wanted to make the transition from young Singe to older Singe very similar, and we spoke about accents and a lot of things, of the way Singe was, and we worked closely with Singe as well, trying to get the ins and out of Singe as a character right, so it looked fluid in the film, and I think we kind of did that justice, and it was amazing to work with Rafe. He's a beautiful actor, and I learned a lot from him, and he taught me a lot on set, and yeah, I'm grateful to be a part of it.
Curious, when you're playing a real person, is it hard sometimes to draw that distinction between an impression and your own dramatic performance?
Definitely, and that's one of the daunting things about playing, especially a character like Singe, because he was there on set. But he was very supportive, and he gave us all the information you kind of would need to get into that character, even teaching me how to roller skate properly, which I never knew how to. So yeah, that was a big part of the film. And yeah, Singe was great, and I feel like he, being there on set, helped me create the reality of Singe and not just creating a bit of a facade. It was amazing to work with him that closely, and I'm very grateful for that. I think it is important because, one, it's very relatable, and that I think people who are going through this aren't on their own, and it happens to a lot of people, especially cancer. It's 1 in 3 people. 1 in 2 people are affected by it in their lives, and that's a big thing. So it just shows that it happens to everyone, and it shows how you can deal with it. And especially with Kate, she perfectly showed how you can move along and make her kids have the best life possible, and Singe. And that's amazing for me. And that's what I think the film kind of represents.
I think it's the hugest celebration of their love, of Kate and Sinjar's love for each other and for family love, and for, you know, something that I identify with very much about what you feel about bringing up your kids and what you want to give them for the future, and about making the most of every moment in life. Make the most of every single moment that we have, and to realise how precious they are, that the simplest things, you know, what Kate wrote on all those notes and all those, you know, the text that she sent, were all to make memories for the family and for Sinj and for the children. And that's what I think life is about. I don't know that it's changed my perspective on life, but it's because I feel that anyway, and I always have. And it's funny because Kate's message is make the most of every moment. And that's something that I've always said. And I really took that from actually seeing Autopsies and Silent Witness. That's what I took away from it, going, we have to make the most of every moment. So what it did doing this was it sort of highlighted that message. And when we were making the film, lots of people actually, just all they wanted to do, we had a very sensitive crew, was go home to their families at night and literally put their arms around them. And that's, I think, what the film, I hope, makes people feel. They just want to go home and